Just in time for the holidays, it's the second annual Siskel and Ebert Holiday Video Gift Guide.
You don't need this game.
Tonight at 10 on Channel 13.
Chevy Chase tries to survive a family get-together in National Lampoon's Christmas Vacation. It's one of five new movies we'll review this week on Siskel and Ebert, and I'm Roger Ebert of the Chicago Sun-Times.
And I'm Gene Siskel of the Chicago Tribune. Our first film is National Lampoon's Christmas Vacation, and unlike the other two films in this series, this one isn't even remotely funny. It also lacks enterprise. It's the only film in the series where the Griswold family doesn't go anywhere. They stay stuck in their suburban Chicago home, some vacation. Chevy Chase and Beverly D'Angelo again play the Griswolds.
I don't know, Sparky. I just have this feeling.
Ellen, I want to have Christmas here in our house. It means a lot to me. All my life I've wanted to have a big family Christmas.
The joke here is that all sorts of weird relatives descend on the Griswold household, upsetting everything and everyone. After the in-laws show up, it's suddenly scuzzy cousin Randy Quaid and family.
We were gonna call, but Eddie wanted to make it a surprise.
Yeah, you surprised? Surprised, Eddie? If I woke up tomorrow with my head sewn to the carpet, I wouldn't be more surprised than I am right now.
The humor is mostly slapstick, bad slapstick. As, for example, when Chevy Chase is locked in his attic by his mother-in-law.
Ooh. Oh.
Out of perhaps 100 attempts at humor in this picture, and one of them was when Chevy Chase lights up his house with Christmas lights. There are a lot of lights. In fact, it looks like the sun is in that neighborhood. But other than that, the humor is all of the nerdy in-law, nerdy neighbor variety. There's no comic energy in the story. The Griswolds can be funny when they go on vacation, but not here when they stay stuck at home.
Well, I probably laughed more than twice, and I would probably give it a better review than you would, but I can't recommend it. And it seemed to me that what we had here were all the elements, and they just weren't quite firing. For example, when the in-laws turn up, they're not very funny, and they're not really differentiated, and they're not really made very interesting.
They're just standard joke in-laws. I mean,
yeah. In other words, nothing is really done with them. And the whole business of how he gets trapped in the attic, you can see how that could lead to a whole series of physical gags, but really, they don't quite pay off. And over in the movie, I kept thinking, gosh, it's here. They just give it that extra push. Maybe it's the director or...
Well, I'll tell you, the director comes...
Who
the director
just couldn't quite get it over the
it's
top.
It's a first-time director who comes from making TV commercials, and he doesn't make the transition very well. In addition, I really didn't like the film and felt disappointed in it because they can be funny on vacation. Why not take them on a trip again? Mm-hmm. It works twice. Why keep them stuck at home in one location? I thought of Cannonball Run 2, where they didn't have the energy or the wherewithal to take the people on a real cross-country trip.
Yeah.
Why not take these people on
a trip? I'm not sure that's why they didn't go on vacation here, but I wish the movie had gone a little bit more somewhere than where it went.
Coming up next at the movies, a film with Mary Steenburgen playing a woman who does not believe in Christmas.
Santa Claus, how can one sleigh carry all the toys for all the kids every place?
Because it's a magic sleigh. Very magic.
Our next film is called One Magic Christmas, but its real title ought to be One Miserable Woman. I think somewhere buried in this film's intention is the desire to duplicate the same sort of desperation followed by joy that we saw in Frank Capra's classic with Jimmy Stewart, It's a Wonderful Life. Like Jimmy Stewart in that movie, Mary Steenburgen in One Magic Christmas plays a very depressed person. a put-upon woman whose husband loses his job. They're being forced out of their home. She argues with her boss in the supermarket where she works as a checker. Her husband gets shot almost fatally during a bank holdup. Her kids are kidnapped and apparently drowned in a traffic accident. And little does she know that there is, fortunately, a guardian angel watching over her and her family. And in this scene, late in the film, her daughter gets a trip, thanks to the guardian angel, a trip to the North Pole.
Because the Santa Claus in the mall isn't me.
Santa Claus, how can one sleigh carry all the toys for all the kids every place?
Because it's a magic sleigh. Very magic. Do you believe in magic, Abby?
Yeah.
Your lunch, Nicholas?
Oh, yes.
Have a nice trip.
Yes. Take care of Abby. Make sure that she gets home. And I'll see you in the morning.
I'll see you in the morning.
Goodbye, Abby.
Bye, Santa Claus.
Even Santa seems like he's on tranquilizers. Now, when the daughter returns home, her brother doesn't believe where she's been, but little Abby has seen Santa and the guardian angel, so she sticks to her story.
I saw Santa Claus.
But he said you did not see Santa Claus.
I did so, and give me back my glass ball.
Who needs it? I'm going to tell Mom you're back, and you're going to get it, Abby. You're going to get it good.
I told you, Mom. I told you she was back.
You go on back downstairs. I want to talk to Abby for a minute.
Oh, Mom, do I have to?
Yeah, you have to. Go on.
Yes, Mom.
Come on. Let's go to the room.
Abby?
Where have you been? We've all been worried sick.
Been to North Pole Moon, see Santa Claus.
Don't tell me stories like that.
No, Mom, really. Gideon took me there. He can fly. Are you gonna spank me, Mom?
No, I'm not. But you shouldn't tell fibs.
Yes, Mom. But it's true. There is an angel. You know there's an angel. Or Ken and I would be drowned in the river.
See, Gideon is the name of that angel. And boy, wasn't that whole level of that scene there just very, very down and depressing. Her standing in the doorway, mumbling to her son, then mumbling to her daughter. That is the emotional tone of this entire film, except for the happy ending. One Magic Christmas is a very strange movie. It's really unbelievably downbeat to the point it really gets on one's nerves, despite the presence of the usually likable Mary Steenburgen, one of my favorite actresses. And I also think that the fine actor Harry Dean Stanton, he of the craggy face, is wildly miscast as the guardian angel Gideon. Although it's true that he's invisible to other people in this film, we don't know that till midway through the picture about. So we think, as we see him walking through the streets, that he'd be picked up for vagrancy in any town where he spends as much time as he does in this film. So we get all this downbeat stuff for more than an hour, and then whammo, the predictable happy ending that the film simply has not earned. That's why I felt totally manipulated by this movie, and it's the script at its fault. Too much of a downer all the way through.
I've got to agree with you, and I was disappointed because, you know, looking at it from a totally different point of view, it's a very good movie. It was directed by Philip Borsos, the man who made The Gray Fox. Mary Steenburgen is fine in this movie. All the performances are fine. You get to the North Pole, and Santa's workshop looks terrific. The little town where these people, where the family lives, that looks terrific. The acting is good. From a technical point of view, it's a well-made movie, but it's such a tragic miscalculation in terms of the screenplay. That family could have had a little bad luck, you know.
Yes.
He loses his job, they get thrown out of the house. That's enough. We don't have to have three deaths in the family in order to make the point. And that's why it just goes way over the edge, especially for younger kids.
Oh, yeah. They're going to be totally baffled by this movie before it ever gets to the happy ending.
Yeah, it's like it's two separate movies, yeah. Really, because I don't know that there's ever been such an unhappy portrait put on film, period. And then, so then you got this other thing coming in from left field, which is a conventional happy ending. I mean, maybe there should have been something conventionally unhappy about the ending, and it'd be all of a piece. At least that would be honorable. I don't know what to say.
I walked out of the movie just thankful they didn't have a family dog, because it probably would have been run over. Next at the movies, a happier Christmas movie, but then again, what movie wouldn't be happier? This one's called Santa Claus.
If you give extra kisses, you get bigger hugs.
Sorry.
That's what Santa's wife.
Our next movie is named Santa Claus the Movie, and that's good because if it were Santa Claus the Book, it'd never be on our show. It's a big-budget special effects spectacular from Alexander Salkin, the same man who gave us all the Superman movies. He adopts in this one sort of the same approach as he did in the Superman films, starting out with a story of the origin of his latest superhero and then giving him some villains to fight and some friends to help out. Of course, the legend of Santa Claus doesn't begin when Santa's a little baby like Superman was. I guess that's maybe because Santa Claus was never young. It begins when a kindly man named Claus freezes to death while delivering Christmas presents, and his spirit is whisked directly to the North Pole for a chat with the elves, where he gets a promotion of sorts and a new name.
From this day on, now and forever, you will bring our gifts to all the children in all the world. All those within the sound of my voice, and all those on this earth everywhere know, and henceforth, you will be called Santa Claus. And now, everyone, Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
That's Burgess Meredith as the ancient elf there. The movie stars Dudley Moore as Santa's chief elf, and in this scene he tries to make a deal with a cricket toy manufacturer played by John Lithgow.
It better be. How many workers does this product require?
Just me.
What? No payroll?
Well, my needs are simple. A bowl of stew, heavy on the dill, a cold place to sleep.
What would it cost?
Cost? Cost who?
The people who buy the toy.
Well, nothing. We're going to give them away free. Oh, that's fantastic. How do you turn your face so red so fast?
For free?
Well, that's how we do it at the North Pole.
Well, that's not how we do it here, in a free enterprise system. On the other hand, this would go a long way towards cleaning up my public image.
Excuse me?
Oh, it's not a bad investment. All that good PR. Intrigued.
Excuse me, you're drooling on your tie.
The movie spends a lot of time with those two characters, maybe because, let's face it, Santa Claus isn't that interesting. Neither is this movie. It has a lot of fairly good special effects and a funny performance by Dudley Moore and sort of a standard Superman-style villain by John Lithgow, but there's never really any suspense because we never, ever really think that anything very bad is going to happen to Santa Claus. I guess that's maybe because we hadn't seen One Magic Christmas before. I sort of like parts of this movie, but not enough to recommend it. Of course, I might have liked it more if I'd been 7 years old, and maybe that's the idea. At least no families get wiped out in this movie. I mean, a couple of reindeer get the flu, and that's about the extent of it.
Well, I'll tell you, now I think if you hit on the problem. You see, this film, I think, could use more actual conflict in it. You talked about villains going against the superhero, like in Superman, but think about it. There is not one scene in this movie between Santa Claus and John Lithgow.
That's right.
There is no confrontation between the good is good and the most evil.
Really, maybe you should have had a kind of a more megalomaniac global type of villain.
I got a better idea.
I got a great idea. He puts up a force shield that prevents the sled from landing. Wouldn't that be great?
No, I got a better one.
It's up to Dudley Moore.
He kidnaps Santa Claus, and he becomes Santa Claus. You have an evil Santa Claus out there who does all kinds of funny things, not sick things, but funny things, and that's the John Lithgow character. I came up with that. That's worth $500,000 in Hollywood,
I've got the title for the movie, Santa Claus, the second movie. Coming up next,
a special report on the extraordinary success of Home Alone, a film that two supposedly influential movie critics gave thumbs down to not too long ago. Now, what did the audience see that we didn't?
We'll analyze the movie's success when we come back.
Kevin!
Happy holidays, Dave.
Thank you.
There sure is a lot to do during the holidays. In fact, if you're not careful,
Dave,
you could really work up an appetite.
Boy, I'm hungry.
Luckily, Wendy's has a big bacon classic combo, a quarter pound of fresh beef, three strips of bacon, cheese, lots of toppings, biggie fries, and a 20-ounce drink. A delicious meal.
Light the tree.
Here goes. I love the holidays.
Try Wendy's big bacon classic combo.
I didn't know what to get anyone for the holidays. My Aunt Esther is always a mystery. Uncle Charlie, shopping for him is an adventure. Now, my nephew Timmy was easy. All he wanted was, hey, this from Blockbuster Video. Then it hit me. I could make everyone happy at Blockbuster. And with Blockbuster gift certificates, Aunt Esther can rent all kinds of mysteries. Uncle Charlie can choose his own adventures. And I can have a wonderful life.
Blockbuster Video.
Give the gift of entertainment.
Make way for one of America's favorite characters. Can one tiny reindeer save the day on a stormy Christmas Eve? Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, Tuesday at 8, 7 Central and Mountain.
Okay, a little movie named Home Alone bounced around from one studio to another because nobody thought it would have much promise at the box office, but now it's about to become the biggest hit of all films released in 1990. Directed by Chris Columbus and written and produced by John Hughes, who specializes in movies about kids and families and teenagers, and this time, they really hit the jackpot. Almost every scene in the movie involves a previously little-known young actor named Macaulay Culkin, who was inadvertently left home alone when his large extended family and relatives all oversleep and race to the airport without him. The movie follows his adventures as he copes by himself for a few days and even booby-traps his house to foil a couple of would-be thieves.
Heads up! Don't worry, Marv, I'll get him for you.
For nearly 3 months, Home Alone has stood at the top of the box office charts, week after week after week, ahead of even such highly touted blockbusters as Godfather Part 3 and Kindergarten Cop, which also did very well, but not this well. Yet the movie didn't create much of a stir when it was released, except with the public, of course. I voted thumbs down on my review. Gene voted thumbs down on his review. Most critics could really care less about this film, arguing that the movie was too implausible to believe and that no little kid could actually do all of that stuff. I guess maybe that must have been like criticizing West Side Story because it had too much singing and dancing in it. It turned out that the audiences loved the whole package, including the implausibility. But there may also have been some deeper forces at work there. We're living in troubled times right now, and Home Alone offers the exact opposite of the headlines on the news. It's funny, it's lightweight, it's escapist, it's a fantasy, it's a comedy, it's about a little kid. It shows the kid using his ingenuity to outsmart the bad guys, and the audience seems to be thinking, if a kid could do it, why couldn't I? The implausibility is part of the fun. And to quote another ad about another movie, boy, do we need it now.
Well, I think that the secret has to do with they did tap into a common fear, and we both talked about that in our original reviews, which was being home alone is a frightening thing. I remember the first time I was left home alone without a babysitter, and I stood by the window most of the night just waiting for my family to come home. So that you start with that. What we both felt is that they didn't play it serious, and of course they didn't, much to their success. I just think that the reason, because I'm trying to explain how could we be so off, and if that's what we really are. And I think that maybe it has a lot to do with slapstick, which is such a special taste. In other words, you either buy somebody's idea of physical slapstick or you don't at all. And I didn't laugh at all during all of the stunts pulled out. And I understand that gets wall-to-wall laughs from kids in the audience and
you know,
from adults.
Sooner or later, a book will be written on the cinema of John Hughes, who has had a lot of movies that we've liked very much, like The Breakfast Club and Planes, Trains, and Automobiles.
Yes.
And who takes a very simple idea every time. Look at Ferris Bueller's Day Off. A kid gets a day off from school. Right. Planes, Trains, and Automobiles, two people trying to get home for Thanksgiving.
Right.
Breakfast Club, four kids stuck in detention after school.
Right.
Very simple idea that everybody can identify with and then develops it in a way that is more or less accessible, and yet at the same time there's a little... usually a little current of meaning in there. And this time he really did strike a nerve that he didn't strike for us. But all along, it's interesting that he takes these typical, everyday, universal American experiences. He doesn't go for, it's not monsters, it's not Star Wars, it's just everyday stuff.
Yeah, he's, along with Spielberg, Vincent Canby called Spielberg the poet of suburbia. I guess he might be a lyricist or something. The other thing that was going on in the film was that Christmas subtext. Mm-hmm. And I think that's a very powerful thing. People hunger for a heartfelt Christmas movie, I think, 12 months a year, actually. Mm-hmm. And the business with the neighbor next door, which I thought was so patently obvious, people bought it.
Maybe one other thing we ought to mention, Chris Columbus, the director, does a good job. I mean, this movie could have easily been very badly made, and it's not badly made.
It looks real pretty. Arnold Schwarzenegger, who started the year with a good picture, Eraser, but finished with a loser, Jingle All the Way. The lame story of a workaholic dad who has to hustle to find a sold-out Christmas toy for his son.
Good news! We got a late delivery of Turbo Man at Toy Works! Let's go!
Turbo Man!
Turbo Man!
And that's all there is to the story. None of the Schwarzenegger trademarks of high-tech, big action, or good humor. His three kids' films, Kindergarten Cop, Junior, and now Jingle All the Way, have been lame. He has to learn to select smarter scripts, I think, for family entertainment.
A Christmas Story, a funny memory about growing up in Gary, Indiana.
It's very funny. A Christmas Story is based on the writings of American humorist Gene Shepard, recalling with great accuracy the pains and joys of his growing up in the Midwest in the 40s. The film is a collection of incidents told with an adult narrator looking back on his youth with a smile. For example, a Christmas wish for a BB rifle.
What would you like for Christmas?
Horrified. I heard myself blurted out.
I want an official Red River Carbon Action 2-inch Owens Ball air rifle.
Ooh. No. Shoot your eye out.
Oh, no. It was the classic mother BB gun block. You'll shoot your eye out. That deadly phrase uttered many times before by hundreds of mothers was not surmountable by any means known to kiddom.
Now, one of the funniest scenes in the movie is when little Ralphie visits Santa Claus at a department store and asks for the same rifle.
Come on up there. Ho! Ho! Ho!
Christmas, little boy.
My mind had gone blank. Frantically, I tried to remember what it was I wanted. I was blowing it.
Come on, kid. How about a nice football?
Football? Football? What's a football? With unconscious will, my voice squeaked out.
Football. Okay, get him out of here.
A football? Oh, no! Okay, what was I doing? Wake up, stupid! Wake up! No!
No, I want an official Red Hunter combination. Do you want to get ready by Lee Rifle?
You'll shoot your eye out, kid. Merry Christmas. Ho, ho, ho.
You know, we have seen so many movies lately about people trying to do great things, you know, fly to another planet, save the world. Here is something with just as much tension, and it's about a kid wanting a little BB rifle. It's a sweet movie. And what's great about this movie is that even if that never happened to you, you know that that's a true scene. We remember that emotion from somewhere in our youth. A Christmas Story is full of wonderful scenes like those. It's a fragile movie, no sex, no violence. I really wonder if anyone is going to see it. I sure hope they do.
I'll tell you, my guess is either nobody will go to see it or millions of people will go to see it because it will catch on. It's the kind of movie that everyone could identify with. And from those clips, we might have given the impression that it's sort of a Norman Rockwell movie. But in a way, this is Norman Rockwell as filtered through the pages of Mad Magazine or the National Lampoon, because Gene Shepard has an edge to him.
Yes, he does.
And in this material, he's kind of satirical, and he kind of remembers the bite and even the violence of being a kid and thinking about things so passionately that there's just no room for compromise.
It's a wonderful film, and it was directed by, of all people, Bob Clark, who made two of the films that you and I hate the most, Porky's 1 and Porky's 2. We like what he's remembering this time about his youth.
Way to go, Bob.
This is handled with so much more intelligence and simplicity than the most American films. That's
Romain
what I enjoy.
Always has so much insight into human nature. I can remember when I was in high school. That's a long time ago.
Yes.
When I was 14 years old, a girl wanted to break up with me. And you know what she told me? She said, she likes you. And the moment that I heard that, I just turned away to the one who did like me, you see, because I was such a pushover for the fact that I was being accepted. I think there's something of that in everybody at every age, that one of the most amazingly attractive things about a woman, Gene, is the fact that she likes you.
Well,
that makes her attractive.
Well,
shows what good sense she has.
Yes, I can't argue with that. Can't argue with that at all. I don't know what that has to do with the movie, except that we now know what happened to Roger at 14. Coming up next, Die Hard, with Bruce Willis up against a gang of crazy terrorists who have occupied a skyscraper.
Share the magic of America's best-loved holiday tales this Christmas season. The classics that have warmed the hearts of generations are waiting for you on video cassette from Family Home Entertainment.
Okay, Rudolph, full power!
Like the timeless Christmas treat, Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, with very merry music by Burl Ives. Then, it's everybody's favorite tale of Frosty the Snowman, filled with the songs of the wonderful Jimmy Durante.
You better watch out, you better not cry, you better not cry.
And the great Fred Astaire sings up a storm in Santa Claus is Coming to Town, also starring the voice of Mickey Rooney. There's more Yuletide magic with the Little Drummer Boy, voiced by Greer Garson, Jose Ferrer, and featuring the songs of the Vienna Boys Choir. Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, Frosty the Snowman, Santa Claus is Coming to Town, and the Little Drummer Boy. Video classics for you to take home and treasure this holiday season from Family Home Entertainment.
This Christmas, Pepsi would like to help you celebrate the holidays with a chance of winning a present from Mario in the Pepsi Nintendo Holiday Game, where you could win one of thousands of terrific Nintendo prizes, like these action sets, game packs, and best of all, the sensational new Game Boy. So hurry up and play before it's all over. Look for details on how to win your Nintendo prize wherever you see these Pepsi holiday displays.
One cold winter's eve, Bertie and Grimace wandered McDonald's land in search of
a gift for Ronald.
Got any bright ideas?
When lo and behold, a little star hopped from the heavens and twinkled down to earth.
Look, Grimace, a falling star.
Ooh, maybe we can catch it.
And so they did.
You'll make the perfect gift for Ronald.
The little star was wrapped and ribboned and given, but
oh, dear me.
Twinkle, it didn't.
You see, Bertie and Grimace, a star can never belong just to me. It belongs way up high for everyone to see. So let's wish him home where it'll twinkle and glow.
And so they did as they stood in the snow.
Look, the star's back at home in the sky. Good as new. And I have the best gift of all. Friends like you.
Happy holidays from McDonald's.
Our next movie is named Die Hard, and it stars Bruce Willis as an off-duty policeman who attends an office party in a Los Angeles skyscraper and is overlooked when terrorists occupy the building and round up all of the other people. Hiding out on a floor that's still under construction, he wages a one-man war against the bad guys and maintains radio contact with Reginald Vell Johnson as a cop down on the ground.
I want you to find my wife. Don't ask me how. By then, you'll know how. I want you to tell her something. I want you to tell her that. It took me a while to figure out what a jerk I've been.
The movie is filled with wall-to-wall action, a lot of it based on the inability of the L.A. cops to believe that Willis himself is really a cop and not a tricky terrorist.
Go to the roof.
The car's up there!
Go to the roof!
I promise I'll never
even think about going up in a tall building again.
Die.
you got just a glimpse there of the guy in the beard. That's Alan Rickman, who plays the villain and who's really the most interesting character in the movie, kind of an intellectual guy with delusions of superiority. Die Hard has a lot of action scenes like the one on the roof. So many of them, you're amazed the skyscraper doesn't turn into the towering inferno. They're dropping explosives down the elevator shaft and whole floors are being blown apart. But you can also see there, I think, one of the big weaknesses of the movie, and that's the idiotic behavior of the Los Angeles Police Department. There was one character in this movie, a deputy chief, whose actions are so stupid and so unmotivated and wrong-headed that finally he just brings the movie to a stop every time he opens his mouth. Bad writing. He always says the wrong thing. He understands nothing. And with a movie like this, once you start picking out the loopholes, and there are a lot of them, it doesn't matter how good the stunts or the special effects are, or even how good Bruce Willis is. You just can't stay interested.
I did stay interested because I saw this as really a mano a mano between Bruce Willis, who I think is very good in the film, and Alan Rickman, who is really quite devilish and quite sinister and threatening. And I also like the fact that it is held in the skyscraper, so there is some claustrophobia involving this terrorist, seeming terrorist attack. There's also a byplay relationship between Willis and his woman, his former wife, and they want to get that going. She's one of the people that's being captured. But basically, I thought of two guys trapped in a tower trying to fight it out, and I bought the film.
Well, what about all the cops on the ground? What about this deputy chief?
But they stay away from them.
Willis is brought down to the ground,
yes,
which is a miracle considering that all of the elevator shafts have been dynamited.
I followed him all the way through.
The cop is standing there saying, "We're going to bill you for all the damage you've caused."
Idiotic cops in the Dirty Harry movies, too, laugh at them. Come on, because Harry's smarter.
This is not an idiotic cop. This is idiotic writing a cop like this when it would have been better if he just pushed the action forward instead of constantly being wrong-headed.
One supporting character, two very interesting lead characters.
Hiya, pal.
Macaulay Culkin, the most popular lost kid in movie history, goes astray once again in Home Alone 2, Lost in New York.
Everyone I know who has seen this picture says pretty much the same thing, that it's essentially a carbon copy of the first film, and that was my reaction too. Macaulay Culkin, who else again stars as Kevin, and the second time around, we can really appreciate his talent. He is impossibly cute, and he gives perfect little hesitant line readings as he realizes he and his family have jumped on separate planes for their Christmas vacation.
Oh no, my family's in Florida and I'm in New York. My family's in Florida. I'm in New York.
Little Kevin ends up checking into New York's Plaza Hotel, pretending he's waiting for his father. Naturally, he has a ball with the hotel staff, including bellman Rob Schneider.
Is everything all right, sir? Is the temperature in the room okay?
It's okay.
Do you know how the TV works?
I'm 10 years old. TV's my life.
Well,
I'm sorry. And there's plenty more where that came from.
Out on the streets, as in the first film, he meets a threatening stranger who turns out to be a nice person after all. In this case, a pigeon lady, played by Brenda Fricker, the Oscar winner as the mother in My Left Foot. They have a nice scene together.
Do you know that it's been a couple of years since I've talked to any of you?
That's okay. You're really good at it. You're not boring. You don't mumble or spit when you talk. You should do it more often. I think you just have to wear an outfit that doesn't have pigeon poop on it.
Then the burglars, played by Joe Pesci and Daniel Stern, show up like the coyote in the Roadrunner cartoons to take their licks from Kevin. I gave a marginal thumbs down to the original Home Alone. I really don't like those burglars. This time I appreciated Macaulay Culkin more. He has a special gift. He is positively charming. But this time, too, I felt the burglar scenes were even more annoying. Again, marginal thumbs down for me on Home Alone 2. And I know that every 10-year-old kid in America is going to hate me for it.
Well, I won't hate you for it, Gene, because my thumb is not even marginally down. And I'll tell you why. First of all, I didn't even go for the Brenda Fricker scenes because I thought that they went on way too long. were overwritten and treacly and sentimental and shameless in the way that the little twerp kind of lectures her on the meaning of life and the meaning of truth, and she's so grateful to find out these words of wisdom from his angelic little mouth. And then as far as the burglars are concerned, the violence, which is obviously, you're quite right, modeled on all those cartoons with the Roadrunner and Wile E. Coyote, and they use the wide-angle lens to make it seem that things are really coming from a long way down and slamming on top of everyone, is really tough stuff. You know, usually live-action versions of cartoons don't work because when flesh and blood is involved, it's not that funny.
I do think that this kid is a big talent.
Oh, I think Macaulay Culkin. I'm not criticizing Macaulay Culkin, the actor. I'm criticizing the character Kevin, who a little bit of Kevin goes a long way. I mean, the entire scene in that townhouse when he's dropping 50-pound bags of cement on them and tricking them into sticking their heads into exploding toilets and so forth. I mean, this stuff, it may even sound funny when I describe it, but the fact is eventually
it wears you out.
It gets real old and exhausting.
It wore me out too. When we come back, a remake of the 1947 classic Miracle on 34th Street, this time with Richard Attenborough as Kris Kringle.
It was the night before Christmas, and there in the house, the kitten discovered the new Commodore's mouse. Now touch the mouse to do what you choose. The mouse makes the Commodore simpler to use. Educate. Entertain. Put thoughts together. The world's best-selling family computer just got better. So bring home the new Commodore 64 now. A Commodore Christmas to all. And to all a...
So you think Santa will like these red and green M&Ms?
I don't know. I never met the guy. He does exist!
They do exist.
Santa?
We had just finished trimming the tree, and something weird was coming from the kitchen.
What's a tree doing in here?
Just one of the new shapes for my Christmas Crunch cereal.
Cap'n Crunch?
Christmas Crunch has six crunchy new shapes, like bikes, trains, stars.
He'll never do it.
Even Christmas trees.
He did it.
Then I add my holiday berry flavor, and you've got a crunchy, fruity part of a balanced breakfast. That's three down, only 59 million to go. Christmas Crunch, a whole lot of fun.
Would you be our Santa Claus?
Me?
Well, do you have any experience?
Oh, just a little.
Great, well, I'm sure you'll be fine.
A department store executive spots a potential Santa Claus and hires him on the spot in that scene from Miracle on 34th Street, a new version of the 1947 classic. And if you've seen the original, you won't find many surprises in this remake, which is good-hearted, however, on its own terms. The movie stars Richard Attenborough as Kris Kringle, who becomes the most popular department store Santa in town. But the woman who hired him, played by Elizabeth Perkins, doesn't believe in Santa and has taught her 6-year-old daughter, played by Mara Wilson, to think the same way. The little girl is wise beyond her years as a neighbor finds out at Thanksgiving.
For the chef?
In the loosest sense of the word.
In every sense of the word.
The vegetables are catered, so is dessert.
Thank you, Susan.
You're welcome.
Under the circumstances, the little girl isn't too thrilled by the prospect of a chat with Santa Claus.
I know how this all works. You're an employee of Kohl's.
That is true.
You're a very good Santa Claus.
Thank you.
Your beard stuck on real tight. Usually the store Santa Claus whiskers are too loose.
Right.
Yours look realistic.
That's because they are real. You give them a tug.
But soon something begins to change, and the 6-year-old begins to suspect that maybe there might be more to life after all than her mother's stark realism.
Would it be okay if I thought about this more? Do I have to not believe in Santa Claus right away?
Meanwhile, old Kris Kringle is tricked by evil employees of a rival department store and ends up institutionalized because he insists he really is Santa Claus. Just like in the original film, it all comes down to a court hearing between faith and cynicism.
Well, I would greatly like to oblige Mr. Collins, but I cannot make this reindeer fly.
I didn't think so.
He only flies on Christmas Eve.
I like this movie for its sweet, unhurried tone. It pays tribute to the 1947 film rather than trying to recycle it into some kind of flashy, slick modernism.
nothing will ever replace the original classic with its Oscar-winning performance by Edmund Gwenn as Santa Claus. But by realizing that, the makers of this new Miracle on 34th Street have been able to share some of the same spirit in a holiday film that I think has a lot of quiet charm.
Well, I want to focus on the word quiet. I think we like the same thing here. This is a very respectful film of the other film and of the holiday and of the characters in it. It's very well cast. The writing is clean as can be. Mm-hmm. The scenes play elemental. It's classically made. Mm-hmm. And I think that's why we like it, even though I will tell you that the ending that they came up with, which is different from the classic ending of the first film, doesn't work at all, in my opinion.
Well, oddly enough, Gene, you may be referring to a wedding scene. And since I was married in the same church where that wedding scene takes place, it kind of touched my heart.
I knew you were. In fact, when I took my daughter there, and she was a flower girl in the same, I pointed it out to her, too.
Okay.
Not at all. I'm talking about in the courtroom. And that's which doesn't work at all.
Okay, but otherwise, you like the letters, good. The bags of mail.
You
that came
got
in.
That.
Okay, coming up next.
One of Santa's reindeer needs a temporary home and finds it in Prancer.
Remember that crazy bunch you grew up with?
Those kids were terrific.
Now you can see them again when the whole gang gets together for a very Brady Christmas Friday.
Hope we're going to a New Year's Eve party.
I'd prefer an office party.
I want to go to a school Christmas party.
McDonald's Chicken McNuggets 20-pack, the life of any holiday party.
How do I look?
Delicious. Golden brown is your color.
Whoopee! Let's go to a sleigh ride party.
It's a good time for the great taste.
Parties, parties. Oh. That's all you 20-packs ever think of.
Of McDonald's.
Time for McDonald's gift certificates. 50 cents each or a book of 10 for $5.
If you got a problem, don't care what it is. If you need a hand, I can assure you this. I can help. I got two strong arms. I can help.
Give this summer's action adventure Independence Day at a price that'll make your holiday. Only $14.99 at Blockbuster.
It would sure do me good to do you good. Let me help.
Sweet, effective Christmas story called Prancer, shot on location in southwest Michigan. It tells the story of a little girl named Jessica who lives on a poor farm but becomes a celebrity in town after she discovers a wounded reindeer near her home. A reindeer she believes is Santa's reindeer called Prancer.
I'm sorry, I don't have any time for chit-chat. I know you're not the real Santa.
Whoa, of course I am.
But can you get this letter to him?
Why don't you just put a stamp on it and drop it in the mailbox?
It's too late for that. Please believe me, this is a matter of utmost importance. Prancer's in the shed near my house.
After Jessica's opinion of the reindeer becomes well-known in town, the reindeer is locked up in a Christmas tree lot as a promotional stunt. But Jessica believes this really is Prancer, and she wants to set him free.
Prancer, come on!
Before Jessica gets her wish to liberate Prancer, she has a reconciliation with her gruff father, played by Sam Elliott.
When you were gone last night, I saw what it'd be like around here not to have you around. I love you, Jesse.
What keeps this little fable from being so preposterous are two things. First, the authentic small-town look. And second, and much more important, the lead performance of Rebecca Harrell as little Jessica. She isn't a dazzling, cute Hollywood kid, and that's just perfect. Rather, her heart is dazzling. This is Rebecca Harrell's first film, and she plays it very, very well. Smart and earnest and convincing. We believe that lots of towns in this holiday season have lots of little girls like Jessica, and for that reason, that little girl's performance, I really liked Prancer.
I liked it too, and I liked Rebecca Harrell too. And what I also liked was that they didn't make this movie into kind of a Norman Rockwell Christmas where everybody is ideal and everybody's happy and there's pies in the oven and toys under the tree.
It's tough in the town.
Yes, this apple farm that her father owns and operates is just about to go broke. There isn't much money. Her mother is dead. The Christmas may not be too cheerful for her, and yet she doesn't sit around and complain. She gets out there, and she's got gumption. She finds this reindeer. She hides it in a shed behind the house. She gets a part-time job to buy oats for it. She knows it's Prancer, and by the end of the movie, we practically believe it's Prancer, too, because the reality level of the movie is there. It's not just a fable.
Well, that's where you have to credit the director, John Hancock, for shooting it in a nice location and also shooting it kind of dark and not in the upbeat. When I think of the picture, you know what I think? I think of her wandering out in the woods, in the backwoods. I mean, that's the dominant image, and not the Christmas Carol sweet kind of holiday picture. And it's very, very good on that basis.
Christmas always seems to me like a real dark season, you know. It's cold and dark, despite all of the images in the movies, and this one gets that.
Our next film is only 25 minutes long, but it is a major event in the movie world because it is the first new Mickey Mouse cartoon created in 30 years. It's Mickey's Christmas Carol, an adaptation of the well-known Charles Dickens story, with Mickey as the industrious and underpaid Bob Cratchit and rich old Scrooge McDuck as Bob Cratchit's boss, Scrooge. In this scene, Scrooge is taken by the ghost of Christmas present to see how poor Bob Cratchit and his family are being forced to celebrate the holidays.
Why did you bring me to this old shack?
This is the home of your overworked, underpaid employee, Bob Cratchit.
What's she cooking, a canary? Surely they have more food than that. Look on the fire.
That's your laundry.
Not yet, children. We must wait for Tiny Tim.
Coming, Father. I'm coming. Oh, my. Look at all the wonderful things to eat. We must thank Mr. Scrooge.
Tell me, Spirit, what's wrong with that kind lad?
Much, I'm afraid. If these shadows remain unchanged, I see an empty chair where Tiny Tim once sat.
Now, I may be about to commit professional suicide, because how can you knock a movie with a cute little mouse on a cute little crutch? But that's my feeling, because that scene is deceptive. That is not what the whole movie is about. This movie has very few scenes with Mickey Mouse and his wonderful little family in it. This film does not rank with any of the classic Disney animated features. It's missing Mickey, frankly. He and his family are in far too few scenes. At its best, this is only a genial and slightly colorful little stocking stuffer for kids. And I'll be a Scrooge. I give it thumbs down. I was very disappointed.
I can't believe my ears. Well, you're going to vote against Mickey's Christmas Carol?
Yes.
With Mickey Mouse and Donald Duck? I am too.
Well, of course.
I am too.
Well,
I was disappointed as well. I'll tell you two reasons that I thought. First of all, it's wall-to-wall with words. They talk for the whole 25 minutes. They don't use the magic of visual animation that Disney people are famous for. And secondly, they don't change the story. This is simply Dickens' Christmas Carol. Goes to Christmas past, present, and future, Bob Cratchit, and so forth, just like in the book. Usually, in the old days of the Disney studio, they would have put an ironic spin on it. There would have been something satirical. They would have had fun with it. It would have been Mickey's version of this story. But instead, it's absolutely a forced march through the same old story.
I would have rather have seen the re-release of two of the old classic old Mickey Mouse. I'll stand two of those old cartoons up with this. It was, and you know, I went in there with a real good heart. Yeah. I wanted to love this. I mean, I look forward to it. I wish Disney would make feature-length animated cartoon.
This is a real, real safe movie. They didn't have that extra little artistic push to make it into something a little bit more than exactly what you were expecting. Yeah.
Okay, now let's take another look at the movies we reviewed on this show. Two thumbs down for National Lampoon's Christmas Vacation, which seems to have the makings for a good comedy, but never delivers.
A split vote on the thriller Die Hard. I like the whole movie a lot better than he did. So Die Hard, I recommend.
Two thumbs down for Home Alone 2, Lost in New York. We both agree the violent burglar scenes were overdone.
Two thumbs up, however, for the remake of Miracle on 34th Street. It's not as good as the original, but it's still quite entertaining, and Richard Attenborough makes a convincing Santa. And two more thumbs up for John Hancock's Prancer, the holiday fable featuring a beguiling film debut by Rebecca Harrell.
Two more thumbs down for One Magic Christmas, which is well acted and directed, but was too much of a downer for a holiday movie. And two more downturned thumbs for Santa Claus the movie, not enough conflict between good and evil. And finally, two thumbs down for Mickey's Christmas Carol, a flat, uninspired retelling of the story of Scrooge.
Well, you know, we like Mickey, but we wish there were more of him in this film. A big disappointment.
Okay, that's it for this week. Next week, we'll be back with reviews of big new films starring Steve Martin, Jodie Foster, and Julia Roberts. That's next week, and until then, the balcony is closed.
It's America's favorite jelly bean, Jelly Bellies. Try them, you'll love them. Rice-A-Roni, the San Francisco treat. Now with 30 flavors, you can serve it every day for a month and never serve the same dish twice. Capri moisturizing foam bath and bath beads with natural floral essences and luxurious foam. Capri gives you softer skin. Magla's reversible ironing cover with Teflon-coated design gives you two covers in one. Iron on either side. From Magla Home Helpers.